Have you ever had conversations like this?
This makes no sense. I've never done it like this before. Well, let's call the engineer. Hi, Brendan speaking.
Hi, Brendan. It's Bill. And I'm working on this job in Camberwell.
Look at these plans and I've never done it like this before. It's really confusing.
How come we can't do it the other way that I sent through to you? I've done it 100 times. It's so much easier.
Yeah, look, I understand, but, you know, sometimes situations are slightly different, so sometimes the answers don't come out as we expected. Yes, we do want to try and make it easy to build, but not every situation is the same, unfortunately.
You're just being conservative and over-designing. Can you pull back some of those conservatisms and actually get to something that I can actually build?
It doesn't matter which side of the fence you're on. I'll be going through why people have the feeling that engineers over-design things, why this is not the case, and how you can deal with these situations. My name's Brendan, your structural engineer. Now let's get into it. There's a famous engineering quote that I absolutely love, and I think it completely sums up the situation about why people think we overdesign things. And this is from Dr. A.R. Dykes, where he says, "Engineering is the art of modeling materials we do not wholly understand, into shapes that we cannot precisely analyze, to withstand forces that we cannot properly assess, in such a way that the public has no reason to suspect the extent of our ignorance." When we first break down this quote, it starts to talk about how we cannot properly assess the strength of materials. As materials come in a range of strength, it doesn't always come out at 500 grade steel or 32 MPa concrete. There'll be a range of strengths of what we get. So this is when we're first analyzing materials, we're assessing down at the bottom end of the bell curve of the strength, as we want to make sure that the majority of the material that we're assessing is higher than that. So it depends on the variation of the material that you're looking at. If you've got a higher strength material, which has got more control like steel, potentially you'll be closer to that top end median strength. However, when we're looking at concrete is variable based on placement, how far it's coming, have you put additional water in it? This can all affect the strength of concrete. And it really just depends on the controls that you have in place to ensure that is the case. So that's where the first part of conservatism comes in as an engineer, is not knowing precisely of the material that we're putting onto site, what the strength is that we're going to achieve. The next part of that quote is about analyzing shapes that we cannot precisely analyze. Because when things come to site, it is not a factory. So not everything is going to be in the same location. Not every band beam is going to be the exact depth. Not every bit of reinforcement is going to be at the height that you need to have it. So you need to make sure you've made some allowance for this. So when we're designing, we typically need a construction allowance of plus or minus 10 mils. So this means that the structure will potentially have a lot more strength in it because it's potentially 10 mils lower. But likewise, it could have the other problems as well where it's 10 mils higher, so it could be slightly weaker. It's not the fact that the builder doesn't want to put it in the right location. It's the fact that sometimes site constraints make it hard, as it's really too hard to place the reinforcement precisely in the location that we need to have it. So when we're designing structures, we need to make allowances for this. Analyzing structures is all about statistics. And to help the YouTube algorithm, don't forget to click the like button. Not only does it help me out, but also allows this content to get out to more people. The next part of the quote is about analyzing forces we cannot properly assess. When we're assessing the loading of a structure, we cannot control it after it's built. So we need to put safety factors into the amount of force that we're assessing. So if we've got something that's really precise, we know how big the slabs is, we know how big the columns are, we know what type of screed and other services that are going into the building. These are considered dead loads. And we precisely know roughly how much of this dead load is going to be in the structure. So typically we'll have an amplification of that dead load, but it'll only be 1.2. So it's on the low end as we know how much that load is going to be. But for example, if we've got live loads, things that are moving in and out of the structure, people and other elements like that in the building, this is really just a statistical average of what we think is going to be there. So on these loads, as we don't have as much confidence in them, as we don't want to underestimate the load that's going to be on the structure, we put a higher load factor there. So we've got this load combination that's amplifying the load that we think is going to be on the structure. And these lead people to think that we're over-designing structures, that's potentially have done something easier before and it's worked in the past, but not every situation is the same. The other area where potentially there's a little bit more conservatism is also based on the mechanism of failure. So if we're looking into the codes, we have a material safety factor that reduces the strength of the structure based on its failure mechanism. So if we're first looking at flexure, it potentially has a high material safety factor as the structure gives some warning signs. Where if we're looking more at a shear failure, it has a lower factor of safety as we don't want it to fail in this method, as it will be brittle and sudden and potentially show no warning signs before. So when we're thinking about it, that first factor of safety is that bell curve of the strength of materials, where we're down one end. So the majority of the material will be higher than that strength. Then we're looking at loading. has a similar bell curve, but we've put it up the other end to make sure that we don't underestimate the load that's on the structure. Then what happens is we then add a material safety factor or a load amplification factor that moves these points further apart. And this is where we've got a bigger range between that strength of the material to that failure mode. So even though people may think we're over-designing something, we're potentially only just meeting the code. And this is where, as engineers, we need to make that judgment call and talk people through why we need to do things certain ways. And we can see there's also an overlap. So maybe sometimes everything was done perfectly. The strength of material was there. However, the structure just happened to see an overstrength. The material just happened to be weaker. So at some stages, there will be statistical average, which is in the hundreds of thousands or even more, potentially where nothing has been done wrong completely, but the structure could see a failure still. Just because it's worked in the past doesn't mean it will work in the future. Now, is there some engineers that overdesign things? Well, yes. And maybe this is where some of the concerns from builders come from. But when we're looking at that, we've got that big range from that strength of material to the actual load factor, we realize that we can bring our structures up to a 90% utilization or slightly more. Yes, there is some areas where you want to have a little bit of redundancy, such as connections or other elements that may be super critical where you may throw the materials. But on your typical floors are areas where it's less critical. You potentially want to bring those utilizations up as high as they can go. So when you're talking to builders, this is where you try and take them on the journey about why you need to design something a certain way, why things are that way. Sometimes you may have just had repetition across the structure as you wanted to keep it simple to make it easier for the builder to build. And if the builder's complaining, there may be some other reasons behind that complaint, not just the amount of money they're going to spend in the material that you're putting in the structure. Maybe it's too hard. So maybe by listening to him, you may be able to come up with a different method that both achieves the strength that you need to have, but also achieves the ability of the builder to build the building. Then sometimes you just get those people that just complain. And then really all you can do is say, look, this is the way it needs to be built. We're not going to take responsibility if you don't build it this way, and give them the guidance that this is the reasons why you need to be there. But wherever possible, trying to educate them. So when they're building a structure in the future, they have some knowledge about why things are done a certain way and gives them the confidence of you about how you've approached your design. And as a builder, when you're looking at the structure, just because something works some way doesn't mean it always will. And not every situation is the same, as there will be some variation that maybe means the load is flowing a different way, or the structure is performing a slightly different purpose, hence why it's been designed in a certain way. Now, when you're analyzing buildings, it will also depend on what stage of the construction work you're at. If you're at scheme stage, typically you will have a little bit more conservatism in your design, as there's things you do not completely understand. You don't know where everything's going to go, are you going to add additional floors, where the loading of the structure is going to be, as you don't want to make sure you're at that 100% utilization of the structure, as any minor change will mean a variation. Where the people you're working with are always going, I just changed one little thing, and you're constantly changing something. So you want to make sure that you can allow for those changes. And the further you move through that project scheme, the closer you will push the structure to being that 100% utilized. So when you get to that construction docks, you've pushed the structure as much as you're happy with, trying to push into that 90% range to make sure the structure is efficient as possible. If you enjoy this content and want to support me further, I've got links to my Patreon in the below description, where you can give me a small donation to help make this type of content possible, much like these many members here. And as always, stay safe, keep learning, and I'll see you next week. Bye.